To this third annual Leela Dalmia Memorial Lecture delivered by Ashok Vajpayee. The lecture is presented in conjunction with the Leela Dalmia PICA Research Grant, an annual grant given in support of research in the field of modern and contemporary art with a particular focus on Indian art. The grant aims to set a platform for research and knowledge exchange for independent scholars and curators. The grant is given through an open application process, and I'd like to thank the jury members, Rudina Karodin, Shubhra Savan, and Yashodhara Dalmia, along with me, who helped with the selection process. Both the grant and the lecture have been instituted in the memory of Leela Dalmia, the acclaimed writer who passed away prematurely in 2003. Leela Dalmia's home in Delhi, which she shared with her partner, the legendary Hindi writer Abhinaya, was the hub for literary and artistic activities. The two of them started the critical Hindi magazine for arts and literature, Naya Pratik, which was regarded highly for its experimental writing. Leela also wrote several articles and essays, in particular her biographical novel, Chatpara Parna, and a volume of her collective works titled Leela was published shortly after her demise. She was a generous patron of the arts and supported many young writers and artists, and is remembered by her friends and supporters as an inspirational cultural personality of her time. So this research grant and lecture have been established with the support of her sister Yashodhara Dalmia, who will be with us very shortly. She's just stuck in traffic. She's an art historian and curator based in Delhi, and really needs no introduction. The audience is here, but just to list some of her publications, she's worked on a monograph on Amrita Shetty in 2006. She worked on the making of modern Indian art, The Progressive, in 2001, and co-wrote Memory, Metaphor, Mutations, Contemporary Art of India and Pakistan with Salima Hashmi in 2007. She's currently going to be publishing a book on the Ceylonese artist George Keith, and that's under production. So I really thank Yashodhara for making this support available for independent scholars in India, and it's much needed. So the memorial lecture and the research grant are very closely linked in terms of the topics. And in 2014, we had given the grant, which for the year 2015. Chitra K.S. worked on her project, Mapping the Museum Discourse on Modern Indian Art, and it was a case study of the picture gallery at the Baroda Museum. And she was particularly looking at the decades between 1920 and 1950. And her research explored the history of the Baroda Museum and the picture gallery through its collections and exhibitions. And what she was particularly interested in, and what she researched over the past year, has been on the formation of the classificatory category of modern Indian art and the way the museum redefined itself as an institute of fine art as opposed to a general and educational museum, which is how it sort of identified itself before that period. And Chitra particularly focuses on two major reorganizations that took place in the first half of the 20th century and traces the careers of museologists S. Gambhi and Herman Goetz. So these are the two figures that she sort of has conducted her research around. And she will make her final presentation at the School of Arts and Aesthetics in March, and we'll keep you posted about the dates and time again. So keeping Chitra's research area in mind, we invited Ashok Vajpayee ji to deliver a lecture and share his insights on the cultural terrain. Vajpayee ji has been involved in setting up a number of institutions in the field of culture and education in Madhya Pradesh in particular, but also in other places. And we know of his close involvement with Bharat Bhavan as chairman and the way that J. Swaminathan and he worked together to set it up. But there were also other institutions like the Rupat Kendra, the Kalidas Academy, the Madhya Pradesh Adivasi Lok Kala Parishad, and the Chakradhar Nritya Kendra. So all these institutions that sort of came up. And then he went on to become the founding Vice Chancellor of Mahatma Gandhi International University. And we all particularly remember his stellar efforts to revitalize the Vallikkala Academy in his role as chairman between 2008 and 2011. At present, he's the executive trustee of the Raza Foundation. So, looking at all this experience and all these institutions that he's been instrumental in setting up, the talk today is going to reflect on the impetus of setting up these spaces and how they shaped up. But some of them were able to function successfully and maintain a certain degree of autonomy, while others were misinterpreted and seen as a challenge to the politicized version of culture. Through this personal recounting, Vajpayee is going to look at issues of patronage, public participation, elite passions and facility, and also the dynamics of culture and politics in relation to each other. And I will be presenting a very incomplete picture of him if I just spoke of his illustrious bureaucratic career. He's also a poet, a Hindi poet, and a critic of great repute, and a connoisseur of the arts. Besides 15 books on Hindi poetry, he has written criticism on poetry as well, in English and Hindi, and he has written on culture, visual arts, and music. He's received many awards, Kabir Samman in 2006, Samman Vaya Bhasha Samman in 2014, among others, and has been decorated by high civil awards of France and Poland. More recently, he's been in news for returning awards and honorary degrees to register his police for his protest against state policies. Today's newspapers carried a report of him returning his D-Lit to the Hyderabad Central University following from the suicide of research scholar Rohit Venula. And in 2015, he returned his Saitya Academy Award to protest against growing intolerance and actually sparked off a whole series of writers returning their awards. So I welcome him. And following his talk, Naman Kabuja will open up a small discussion with Vajpayee. And then, of course, invite questions and discussion with all of you. And I can think of no better person than Naman to moderate a discussion with Vajpayee, given his own experience in, as of course, as a professor right here at the school and all the several publications that he has to his credit, and his vast curatorial and museum experience working at the British Museum and Ashley Museum, Oxford, and the wonderful recent exhibition that he did, The Body of Indian Art. So, yes, welcome.
My friends,
I perhaps soon have a reputation of not retaining anything that I got, give it away, returning it. And finally, if you look at my biography and administration, I declined many jobs. So that history is quite impressive than what I accepted. So finally, this is going to happen about that also. But I'm very happy to be speaking to you this evening in the Ila Dalmia Memorial Lecture. I happen to know Ilaji quite well, and I remain very grateful to her because my relationship with one of the major Hindi writers again got soiled because as a young, impetuous, immature, but bold critic, I wrote a very devastating review of his book, and taking the cue from T.S. Eliot's famous line, "Why should the old eagle stretch its wings?" That article hurt him so much that for 17 years, he would not come to anything to which I invited him. Finally, it was Ila who had become his companion, who sorted it out, and just a few days before he died, he finally came to Bhopal, to Bharat Bhavan, etc. So I remember him very fondly, and she gave me kaftan, no? A specially made kaftan, which I today looked for and looked rather crumbled, and the presswala had left. So I thought, I can't go to JNU looking very crumbled. Only students and teachers here can
a fourth will be crumbled, but not the guest. Anyway, so I couldn't. And she also gave me one of the, when Agili passed away, and when she was sort of making, so she gave me as a gift one of the leather bags that Agili used to use. He was such a big writer, and I held him in such awe. In fact, the whole Hindi world used to hold him in awe. And I never dared use it, because I thought it was too preposterous for me to use. So it's there. Anyway, now, I have called this between hope and despair. Hope that was, and despair that is. Now, how to negotiate between these. I spent a major part of my life building, running, being made to give up institutions. And my experience has been both exhilarating and truly despairing. Raman Mohan Lohia had used the term duties of despair. So one of the duties of despair is to assess yourself, to look back and find out what happened and how it happened. I started my cultural journey. I think usko Hindi mein kehne se zyada acha banta hai. Maine apna sanskritik utpat 1972 mein shuru kiya. In 1972, when as a young civil servant, I came to Bhopal as a deputy secretary. The happy circumstance was that I happened to be a collector of Sidhi, where I ran into Arjun Singh, the well-known Congress politician. And I used, you know, he was a man of few words. For instance, the first meeting when he came to see me as collector, my wife says, the meeting lasted 45 minutes. You spoke for 42 minutes. He spoke for 1 minute, and the rest was silence. So I told my wife that he doesn't speak. What do I do? I can't possibly be staring at him and sitting quietly. I'm a talkative man. I'm a man of words. Anyway, so I used to lecture him. If state has responsibility in education, in industry, in agriculture, in irrigation, why doesn't have responsibility in culture? He did not say anything. It so happened that I got transferred from that district, went to do another collectorship, and then came back. And soon Arjun Singh became the chief minister, or the education minister. And one day he got hold of me that you used to lecture me that the state should do something in culture. Now, you should decide what has to be done, and you have to do it. So that's how the whole thing started. But to recall what was the scene in the realm of culture in the early 70s, by that time, I think the Nehru Azad vision of culture has been substantially diluted, and the institutions they were set up and sort of the vision which was there, the liberal vision if you like, or the pluralistic vision if you should, then that vision was getting diluted, distorted, misinterpreted. And if you remember, even at the national level, the academies were being examined again and again. Our three national academies have the most rare distinction of being scrutinized 4 times by a Khanna committee, by a Haksar committee, by a Abhijit Das Gupta committee, and there might be another committee being set up for all I know. And the remarkable thing about them is that in spite of these committees, they continue to remain what they were. There were some cosmetic changes here and there, but that's a long story. The states were reluctant to do anything in the realm of culture. Most states, in fact, had not even set up, although 15 years after independence had passed, 25 years had passed, state academies or any other substantial institutions to promote culture. The states were kind of not, and some of them have not done it till date. Even now, there are states which have no academies or any of these kinds of institutions. For instance, Maharashtra, which is otherwise a very vibrant cultural scene, doesn't have state academies. So, and the other thing was that even in politics, the liberal, well-informed politician and well-informed bureaucrats started, the numbers started coming down. If you remember, Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia or EMS Namboodiri Pal, there are very few names of great politicians who were interested, Ramakrishna Hegde later, very few politicians who had interest in culture. So you had a brand of politicians who were both in the center and in the states particularly, who had no interest in culture and who were unconcerned with culture and very ill-informed. The artistic community of India, in any case, remained very fragmented, sometimes on ideological grounds, but more often on just personal jealousies or whatever. So there was no pressure on the artistic community. In fact, it's very interesting that what I did in Madhya Pradesh was not in response to any pressure by the artistic community. They wanted this. It just came into my head that this is something which we should do rather than the other way around. So the cultural community and the state culture relationship was being looked at with great suspicion, both by the state and also by culture itself. You know, in Allahabad in the 50s, there was a huge conference, Sahitya or Rajyashray, State Patronage and Literature. And of course, the tone was that state patronage must be avoided at all costs. And it had very famous people taking part in it, Umashankar Joshi, etc. One other notion which seemed to have created this impression was that culture is the business of the people, is the business of the community. It is people and the community which create culture, which sustain culture, which nourish culture. And the state should have nothing to do with it. There was this culture policy debate. And the, you know, again, the attempts. I was first, when I came to the central government, the joint secretary, my secretary told me, you have to do two things. One, draft a national culture policy. And two, create a multi-art center like Bharat Bhavan in Delhi. I failed to do either. I made all the attempts. I made the draft. And I was, national culture policy draft has been made four times. And none of them has been accepted. And the debate was that there, how can the state prescribe culture? And my attempts to explain that this is not going to be a policy for culture per se. This is only going to be a policy which will govern public action, that is state-funded action in the realm of culture. Should there be, how should the museums be run, what kind of, other facilities, cultural infrastructure, etc. But this did not cut much ice, and anyway, preservation of heritage became one of the concerns. Although how heritage had been preserved and what has happened to that preservation is an open question. But that was the idea which was brought to be in an adversarial relationship with contemporary creativity. So contemporary creativity was mistrusted, and preservation of heritage was very laudable, very desirable, and things of that kind. So that kept on happening, where contemporary creativity found little place in the cultural schemes of things. Academic world also don't seem to have studied the dynamics or the complexity of the